Hi, welcome to Collective Cell Dynamics Lab. In this lab, we are interested in understanding how forces affect the biological processes. Especially, we are trying to measure the forces which are exerted between the cell and the extracellular matrix and between two cells. And we are trying to understand that how these forces in principle affect some of the biological processes like collective migration of cells that happens during wound healing, or the cell competition, which is at the very basic level of how our tissue maintains its quality and gets rid of the cancerous cells. In addition, we are interested in understanding that in a sort of broader way, how the tissue mechanics influences different biological processes. So for this, we use an extensively cell culture microscopy as well as a lot of biophysical tools. Why don't you take a tour of the lab now?
So let us take a tour of the CCD lab.
Okay, very nice to welcome us.
CCD sounds like Cafe Coffee Day, but I think it stands for Collective Cellular Dynamics Lab. And it says, please remove shoes before entering. So now we are entering the cell culture.
Hi, hey, are you busy? Just give me 2 minutes. Okay. You can come in, but give me 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, so tell me.
Hi, so I was looking around while you were busy adding things to certain plasticware, but I couldn't make out what actually do you do here. I know it's called cell culture, but what is exactly that you're doing here?
Okay, so as you read outside, this is the cell culture facility. And what we basically do in a cell culture facility is basically culture cells. So what I mean by that is that as humans are growing, similar to that, we need to grow cells, right? And to do that, we need certain specialized equipment, certain specialized material, which we basically keep here, and then we culture cells.
So you switched on something on this chamber. What was that?
So this is a laminar hood. So, and what I just switched on was ultraviolet light. And why I did that was to basically maintain a sterilized environment. So UV sort of acts as a killing agent. So must, just like how we are taught in our school days that if we are hit by the sun's UV light, then we'll probably die. So similar to that, what we do is we maintain a sterilized environment, and for that we switch on the UV.
And I also saw some solutions, ethanol or alcohol.
Right. Yeah. So this is one way of doing that. There, of course, are other means of maintaining a sterilized environment. So another way we do is basically use 70% ethanol solution. It's similar to what people are nowadays using sanitizer for. So it basically acts as a disinfectant, and it kills any microorganism which might be populating our hands and other areas. So to clean out our benches, to clean out our hands, to clean out the surfaces of whatever we are going to use, we disinfect with 70% ethanol. And that is what you saw me spraying around.
And what are these big, something that I think looks like a refrigerator?
Oh yeah, no. So these are not really refrigerators. Refrigerator is the one you see there. These are what are called incubators. What they basically do is they provide cells with such an environment so that they can grow and flourish. So for us, this environment is enough for basically our growth. But to maintain cells, we cannot let them just grow like that. So they require certain kinds of, you know, growth conditions. One of the most important growth condition is the temperature. So what you see here, this temperature in degrees Celsius, this is maintained at 37. So this 37 degrees Celsius temperature is optimum for cell growth. And that is what these machines here do. On top of that, what cells additionally require is some CO2 concentration. The one which is present in the air is not sufficient for them to grow. So what this machine does is that it is attached to these cylinders here, you see, right? These are carbon dioxide cylinders. And what they do is through these blue pipes, they pump carbon dioxide to these incubators, and they have a certain system through which they maintain carbon dioxide inside at a level of about 5% air pressure. So these two things are the most important conditions which cells require to grow, and that is what we maintain.
So I saw you add a red colored liquid to those plastic ware. What was that?
Oh, so that liquid which you saw me adding was basically what is called a culture medium. So what it is basically food for cells to grow. And that is what I was adding to the plastic ware which you saw me earlier. So before I go take out the medium, I'll sprinkle some of the disinfectant so that we have sterilized our hands. This is what is called a culture medium. And this is the red colored fluid which you saw me adding earlier. What it has is basically components which are required, chemical compounds which are required for cells to grow. So one of the major things it has is glucose, because it is the carbon source which cells utilize to grow. Other than that, there are vitamins, there are other amino acids which are essential for cells to grow. The red color is imparted by a dye which is added just to showcase the health of the cells, which is called phenol red. So what I did earlier was splitting cells. So what I mean by splitting cells is basically, I can maybe show you with an example. So here I have a culture flask, you see, and this flask is basically where cells are growing and flourishing. You see the bottom. If I just compare it against the light, you might be able to see that the bottom region is a bit cloudy. So that is what this is how cells would look like under light. And how they grow here is basically what they spread throughout this surface which we have provided them. So once they have covered the whole surface, of course, if the cells, we need the cells to grow further, we of course need to give them more area, right? So either we can increase the surface area on which they are growing, or what we do is called splitting cells. So what we do is we basically take them off the substrate, we collect them, and then we add it to a fresh flask where they can flourish next. And by this way, what we can do is basically maintain cells in culture and then use them for our experiments. So
can I have a look at those cells? Is it possible?
Of course.
With the naked eye?
So with the naked eye, you'll be able to see this cloudy thing. But if you really want to see cells, what we have here is a microscope. And I think you'll find it more fascinating if you look it under the microscope. So let's go on the microscope and have a look at it. So here you go. So now here what you see is basically cells that are four times higher magnification. So you're seeing them as four times the size they actually are. And this is the lowest magnification this microscope will offer right now.
Can we go at a higher magnification?
Yeah, we definitely can. Next we can maybe try a 20 times magnification and let's see how it goes.
So this is at 20x.
This is at 20 times the magnification.
And I can see some bright lines, right? Are these the boundaries?
Yes, so these are the boundaries shared by neighboring cells.
Okay.
And that's how these particular cell lines, these particular cells grow.
And the highest you said was 40x on this?
Yes, the highest would be 40x. So let's go to 40x. So now what you see here is a magnification of 40 times the actual size of the cells.
This is actually quite fascinating. I see some circular structures now.
Yes, so what you see, the bigger circular structures inside each of these cells is the nucleus of the cell. That is sort of what acts equivalent to what our brain does to our body. It basically controls the major functionality of the cell.
Yeah, but there would be other structures, and will it be possible for us to magnify them further and have a look?
So there are definitely other structures than the nucleus in these cells. But as of now, we won't be able to magnify it further with this particular microscope. But if you are still fascinated and you want to look at the other structures, you can actually talk to one of our microscopy experts, Satya.
So we are now going into the microscopy room. Satya, are you busy? Can I talk
to you? No, it's okay.
Yeah, so I was talking to Pravar.
Yeah.
And he showed me some cells under a microscope.
Yeah.
They look really good, but I didn't follow, how the microscope works.
Okay.
So can you help me out?
Yeah, of course. An optical microscope is an instrument which is developed in such a way that it can produce magnified and resolved image which we can't see with our naked eyes.
So you said magnified and resolved. Are these different?
Yeah, different. As you heard about that, in December 2020, there is an astronomical event called as the Great Conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn, where Jupiter and Saturn came close to each other. So on that day, I click a mobile picture. The left one is the mobile picture and the right one is taken by a telescope. On that mobile picture, I just zoomed the Jupiter and Saturn, and I have observed that there is only one spot I have observed. But in the case of telescope, we have observed two points, Jupiter and Saturn, both with distinguishable manner. So this happened because the telescope have a higher magnification also and a higher resolution. In microscope also, there is a device called as the objective lens. Here you can see there is several objective lens with several magnification, and this objective lens help us to magnify the specimen as well as to provide a higher resolution image of the specimen. There are several other important parts of the microscope also. Here is the microscope, and this is the halogen lamp of the microscope, and it provides the illumination light to the sample plane. And here is the sample stage where we can put the specimen under here, and under the sample plane there is a objective turret. In that turret, several objective we can mount there, so that we can image the sample with different magnification and resolution. Okay, then the light goes down, and then there is some beam splitter so that it splits the beam towards the eyepiece. Here we can observe the biological specimen here, whether it focused or not. Here we can focus by this focus knob. And also another part of light is gets deviated towards another port of microscope, and goes towards the camera, and in the camera we can capture the image of the sample placed on the sample microscope stage.
The microscope I saw in cell culture was a little different than this one.
Yeah.
So are there any differences in microscopes?
Yeah, there are several types of microscope based on illumination path or detection path. So based on illumination path, the microscope can be divided into several types: wide field microscope, confocal microscope. Based on the detection path, the microscope can be divided into several types, such as bright field microscope, reflection mode microscope, and fluorescent microscope. In bright field microscope, the transmitted light from the sample gets detected by the detector, whereas in reflected light microscopy, the reflected light from the sample gets detected by the detector. Before going to the fluorescent mode, let me explain the fluorescent phenomena. Some molecules in nature, when it illuminated by a particular wavelength or particular color of light, let's say blue, it get the blue light is absorbed by the molecule and it emit a another wavelength of light, let's say green. The green light is emitted from the molecule, and that we use that green light to detect the molecule. We use that green light in the microscope. That is called the fluorescent microscopy. Now let me show you the principle of working principle of fluorescent microscopy. Here a source of white light gets incident to the excitation filter, and from excitation filter a blue light is reflected by the dichroic mirror and gets to the specimen, and from specimen in a fluorescent light, let's call the green light, is is coming from the specimen and transmitted by the dichroic mirror and emission filter to the detector for detection purpose. Okay, and this excitation filter and dichroic mirror and emission filter, and these three in microscope is combinedly put in a fluorescent filter tube. Yeah.
Do you have a filter cube? Can you show us?
Yeah, we have a filter cube. You can see this is a filter cube, and this this is the dichroic mirror, and this is the emission filter, or this is the excitation filter here.
We take a white light and pass through the excitation filter, and it reflects by the dielectric mirror and goes to the sample plane. And the sample plane, you can see in the paper, the blue light is going to the sample. And if the sample emits green light, then it pass through the dielectric mirror and emission filter to the passes through the detector to detect.
A very cool technique, Satya, but I was wondering how would you use this in biological samples?
Yeah, in biological sample, as we explained that the molecules, the fluorescent molecule, we can tag them different structures in the biological sample so that we can image by the said technique, the fluorescent microscope technique.
So I saw some structures in 40x objective, but yeah. Now if you want to look at detailed structures, how do we do that?
Yeah, we have a set of objective lens like 40x, 60x, 100x and with different magnification so that we can image more detail into the cell. But there are certain limitations of the microscope so that it cannot go beyond that limitation. That is called the resolution limit. And for going beyond the resolution limit, there are several techniques such as electron microscopy techniques and for optical microscope, there is super resolution microscope technique. But they are tedious and very costly for implementing that one. But in our lab, we have a very cost effective and convenient way to explore the minute detail that goes beyond the resolution limit. That technique is called that expansion microscopy. You can ask Simran or Prabhu.
Hi Pravar.
Oh, hi again.
So Satya told me about resolution and magnification, and he mentioned a very interesting technique called expansion microscopy.
Right.
So could you tell me about it?
Yeah, definitely. So expansion microscopy is one of the recent techniques which achieves super resolution, which is not achievable by conventional microscopes. So what expansion microscopy basically does with the cells or the specimen is basically it physically expands the cell so that we can achieve greater resolution. And how we do that is basically we embed the specimen or the tissue or the cells in a resin. And funny story, that resin is actually inspired from something which is used in diapers, and it has a property wherein it can absorb water and it expands. So inspired from that, what people have developed is that they use the same resin to embed the specimen and then physically expand using water. So what we essentially do here is that we expand the specimen, the cells, and then we are able to resolve the structures which are not resolvable by conventional microscopy. Since you are interested, you seem to be interested in that, my colleague Simran is right here, and she's already working on one of the experiments with expansion microscopy. And why don't you go ahead and talk to her.
So now we are going to Simran, who will tell us about expansion. Hi, Simran.
Hi.
So Prawal told us that you do a very cool technique in the lab called expansion microscopy.
Yeah, so I am doing expansion microscopy today. And so I think Prawal has told you the principle and everything that why are we using expansion microscopy to get better resolution and see the internal structure of the cells. So basically the protocol involves four major steps: fixation, and then embedding of the sample or our cells into the gel, and which is going to expand, and next step is the homogenization, and last and the final step is the expansion. And I'm going to show you each of the steps right now. So this is the petri dish. You have seen how we culture the cells. I have taken it out of the incubator. I'm going to aspirate the media out of it and add the fixator and fix the cells.
So what is the purpose of this fixing?
So basically what we want is we want to preserve all the internal structure of the cell. So what this fixative is going to do is arrest everything that's happening inside the cell and preserve each and every internal structure as it is. So now we are going to keep the cells with the fixative for 15 minutes, and then we'll wash and move to the next step, which is the embedding. Okay, so 15 minutes are over. We have washed the cells, and we have taken out the cover slips and kept it here. Now we are going to move to the next step, which is embedding. In this step, basically, we have to embed the cells or our sample into the gel or into the monomer solution and let it polymerize and solidify around our sample. So how we are going to do it basically, so this is the monomer solution. I'm going to add 2 drops of the monomer solution over here, and then I'm going to put these cover slip which contains my cell onto the solution. Now we are going to keep this at 37 degrees for 1 hour and let it polymerize and solidify, and then the cells will basically be embedded into the gel matrix. So it's been 1 hour, our gel has polymerized and it has our sample in it. Now we are going to homogenize the sample before we add water and expand it.
So your cells are already embedded in the polymer mix, right? So what will happen if we just add the water now? They should expand, right?
Yeah, so in principle, if I add water to this to these gels, they should expand. But the problem here is that we have cells in here, and in case of cells, there are some places which are probably more dense as compared to the other places inside the cell, and in that case the expansion will not be even. Some parts will expand faster and more, and some parts will expand slower and probably less, and we don't want that. We want an even expansion of the whole sample. For that we are going to do this step where we are going to put the these gels in a homogenization mixture and put it at 70 degrees for 1 hour, and then we are going to do the final and the most important step of the protocol, which is adding water and expansion. So I am going to gently remove my gels, which are, you can see that they have solidified, and put it here. Now this 6-well plate contains the homogenization mixture. I'm going to add and put my gels in this, and then keep it at 70 degrees for 1 hour. Okay, it's been 1 hour now, and I have taken the gels out of the oven, and you can, I put them on these petri dishes, and you can already see that they have expanded a little bit. Now we are going to do the final step of expansion, where we are going to add water. Yeah, so I'm going to add excess of water. And now we will see in 30 minutes that the gel will be expanded. So basically we are going to do 3 rounds of expansion, 30 minutes, 30 minutes, and then 1 overnight expansion. And by the end of it, we will see that the gel will expand to 5 times of its original size.
So I just finished my tour of the CCD lab, had a really fun and exciting time, learned a lot of new things, and I think you guys also have a lot of questions, so please feel free to ask them.